Hi, I'm Mike Hutchins, Extension Dairy Specialist at the University of Illinois. This module will discuss forage aspects in the dairy ration. The role of forage is varied. First, we recognize it is the cheapest source of nutrients in most regions of the United States. Secondly, it makes up a major portion of the ration, varying from 50 to 60% for high-producing cows to nearly 80 to 100% for dry cows and growing heifers. It also is important for maintaining rumen health and function, as it causes the rumination and maintains proper rumen function. Fourthly, forages also provide a fiber source for microbes to produce acetic acid and maintain normal growth in the program. When we look at the types of forages found in dairy rations, we can look at four rather large categories. We'll go through each of these charts very carefully to be sure we understand the various parts of them. Let's first look at legumes. Legumes would consist of such things as alfalfa, clovers, and other legume crops. The yields typically would be fairly high, 4 to 6 tons of dry matter per acre. The harvest stage for optimal quality for high-producing cows would be in the bud stage to 1/4 bloom. The protein levels in this type of forage will be in 20+% crude protein, most of it quite degradable. And finally, the energy content would be around 0.6 mcals per pound of dry matter. Let's compare that to our second category, grasses. This would include such things as brome, grass, fescues, and those types of materials. The yields you can see are slightly lower, ranging from 2 to 4 tons of dry matter per acre, realizing these values can differ greatly from year to year and from farm to farm and region to region. The harvest stage would be in the vegetative stage, or no heads showing. The protein content generally is slightly lower, typically in that 16 to 17% protein range for high quality, and the energy value would be slightly lower at around 0.55 mcals per pound of dry matter. Another resource are small grain forages. Wheat silage, barley hay, oat hay, triticale kale would fall in this category. These yields, again, are even smaller in that 1 to 2 ton of dry matter per acre. This, of course, usually is a double crop system taken off very early in spring, and in many cases allows for a second crop to come onto the farm, and is one of the first forages harvested on most farms if it was a winter small grain crop. For harvest stage, which means the heads are just starting to merge coming out of the plant itself, no head should be showing for high producing, high quality feed. If you go to a dough stage, which means if you take the kernel and squeeze it between your fingers, you'll get a doughy consistency. You will increase tonnage almost twice as high, but the quality dramatically drops. In the boot stage, the protein content will be around 15 or 16% protein, while in the dough stage, it will be quite a bit lower, 10 to 12% protein. The net energy values will be modestly high at over 0.6 for small grain forages in the boot stage and dropping down below 0.5 in the dough stage as this crop is heading towards a straw-like material. The fourth major type of forages would be corn silage, or sometimes referred to as maize silage. You'll notice that it has the highest yield production potential, especially here in Illinois, at 6 to 8 tons of dry matter per acre. The harvest stage should be at 1/4 milk line, which means if you take the kernel and look at it, or cut it in half, you'll see that about a top quarter of it will be starch or very hard, and the bottom 3/4 will be in a liquid or milk stage. Another good guideline is around 33 to 35% dry matter. The protein content is quite low, as you'll notice, around 8 to 9% on a 100% dry matter base. The energy is the highest at 0.72 mcals. As we noticed earlier, quality can vary greatly. And what are the factors that can affect forage quality? Well, certainly the biggest one will be stage of maturity. As plants mature, the cell wall gets thicker and becomes more lignified, reducing digestibility and availability of nutrients. The leaf-to-stem ratio is also equally important, especially on grasses and legumes, because the highest quality nutrients are found in the leaf. So if you have more leaf, you'll have more protein and more energy and less fiber content in the feed. Harvest losses can be significant due to such things as insect losses, rain damage, handling losses, and then before it gets into the actual storage structure. These losses can be as low as 3 to 4% and as high as 50%. Obviously, soil fertility will affect quality because it affects growing condition and rates of growth. And finally, of course, the actual growing condition itself. How much sunlight we have, the temperature we have, and the amount of moisture can affect the lignification process and how quickly the plant will mature. In review, forage fiber sources, again, can vary from plant to plant and from species to species. The three types we talked about are acid detergent fiber, and this relates to forage digestibility and is used very commonly to estimate the energy content of a given forage. The second one, NDF, or neutral detergent fiber, relates to dry matter intake, indicates the amount of bulk, also referred to as cell wall. Lignin is the indigestible fraction of the forage. It tends to wall off nutrients and reduce fermentation and digestibility. Another consideration on the forage system is how to harvest it. And again, we can see several different approaches to reflect the other four kinds of crops. So this table becomes very large very quickly because we'll have legumes, grasses, small grains, and corn silage in each of these categories. But let's go to these various forms. First, the most common one on many farms because of its ease of handling and storage would be hay. The dry matter normally is over 78% or higher. If you go to the very large, big square packages, it even has to be drier because of its inability to lose moisture and heat. Notice we have losses, and in this table we'll have field loss with a diagonal with harvest loss followed by the feeding loss. So with baled hay, we could expect about a 10% field loss, 5% in the harvesting loss, and 11% during the feed. So you can see certain ways of handling forages really shift these losses around. What are some other considerations we would have with hay? Adding propionic acid or salts of propionic acid will retard mold and preserve the crop. You can also buy a drying agent. A drying agent is a dry product that helps remove moisture from the plant when it's laying out in the field. Thirdly, you can also add ammonia to hay, again, as serving as a preservative. So those are some other neat aspects of the hay harvesting system. Let's now go out down to the silage harvesting system for forages. The dry matter of this crop is quite a bit wetter, varying from 30 to 60% dry matter depending if it's corn silage at 30 to haylage at 60% dry matter, especially it depends on the type of storage structure we're in. Structures such as an upright silo, which would be wetter, versus a harvester, which would be drier. Notice the losses are quite a bit lower, typically in that 5% field loss, 5% harvest loss, 5% feeding loss. The reason for the lower field loss is because the crop lays out there for 1 to 1.5 days shorter. The harvest loss is similar because we still usually have to rake or move the hay, but the feeding loss is lower because now we have a chopped silage and the cows do not sort it or pull it out of the bunk quite as aggressively. Comments here is that all silages should be inoculated to ensure good fermentation profile, and the particle size should be checked with a Penn State particle size box to determine if we have the right length of chop to get good rumination and intake potential and also ferment properly in the silo or storage structure. The third form would be green chop. Simply means that we harvest the green growing crop and take it to the cows. The dry matter will be quite low in this one, down around 20% dry matter. Obviously, field loss and harvest loss are very, very low because we harvest it as a growing plant. The feeding loss would be very similar to silage. However, under comments, the big one would be the quality changes every day. So it means the hay that I harvest or the alfalfa or grass I harvested today or tomorrow will be much different than a week from now. So quality of feed is very difficult to maintain. And then every day we must go out every 12 to 18 hours and harvest this crop for the animal. So it is very labor intensive and requires very specific equipment. It can be a real problem in rainy weather because fields get very wet and we can tear up the field itself. The other form of forage harvesting would be pasture. In this system, the cow harvests the feed herself. Again, dry matters of pasture will be very, very low because this is very lush, rapidly growing forages. Now you can see losses depending primarily our field losses. This is trampling and also defecation and selection of the feed by the cow. These losses can be as high as 30 to 40% and as low as 10 or 15% depending on how intensively we manage the pasture. So the comment we have there takes excellent management, and again, quality changes become a big factor. Another aspect of the forage system is to test it for its quality. There are about 3 or 4 different kinds of tests. The first test is referred to as wet chemistry. This is the most expensive test of the two most common field tests, running in the range of $20 to $35 per sample, depending how extensive the test is going to be. This requires several days to complete because it goes through a number of very sophisticated chemical analysis, requiring time and a great deal of labor. However, the wet chemistry is considered the gold standard. This is what everybody compares it to because you get very exact answers. For example, Keldahl analysis for protein, acid detergent fiber tests would be done with chemicals with either neutral or acid detergent to determine those values as well. The newer test is called NIR, or Near Infrared Reflectance Spectrophotometry, which means that we actually shoot light beams at a sample of forage. Because it is done very quickly, it is very inexpensive, typically in the $6 to $10 per sample. However, it only sees organic molecules such as protein, fiber, and starch. It doesn't see minerals, so therefore calcium, phosphorus, magnesium tests would not be very accurate because the lights do not reflect from those bonds. Really what happens in the NIR analyses is that we chemically test the feed with wet chemistry, and then we tell the computer what it saw. So the next time it sees that same type of scan, it says, ah, that's alfalfa containing 18% protein and 29% ADF or whatever number it is. So it really is just has seen the mineral before or the feed before. If it has not seen the feed before, it is called an outlier, and now it has to be tested by wet chemistry. Once that result is then known, it is put into the equation for the computer, so the next time it sees it, it will identify it. Of course, the beauty of it is that when the feed comes in, it can be rapidly dried, ground down, and seen or light shown through it, and turnaround time can be in one day. The other two tests at the bottom are very extensive tests, one called in vitro, which simply means we take rumen fluid from a cow, mix the feed with it in a flask, and run it in a laboratory to determine how degradable or how undigestible the product is going to be. The cost of this test can vary from $20 to $50. The other one is called in situ, another rumen fluid type driven program, but in this case we take the feed sample, put it in a small Dacron bag, and put it inside the cow's stomach, and therefore the cow's stomach becomes the incubator. And as you can anticipate, this is a much more expensive test, typically in the $150 to $300 range, but really mimics exactly what's happening to the feed inside the cow's stomach. Now let's look at recommended forage tests, how often and which tests to run. Here in the Midwest, we would recommend dry matter to be done on a weekly basis on the farm using some type of a Coster tester or some type of a microwave oven, primarily to allow for accurate mixing and monitoring of feed dry matter. Crude protein should be tested on a quarterly basis or whenever the farmer, nutritionist, or veterinarian determines a major change has occurred due to changing silos, changing of colors, changing consistency, or a different band or layer in the storage structure. Similarly, acid detergent fiber and neutral detergent fiber should be tested on the same frequency as crude protein, as would calcium and phosphorus. So all of these would be grouped into as needs basis or a more on a timely or quarterly basis. We go to the other macro and micro minerals. The other macro minerals would be such things as potassium, magnesium. The trace minerals would be like zinc and copper. I would recommend we do that once a year to determine a baseline for the farm because these numbers will not change very much. They are very common because of the various feedstuffs that are raised on the farm reflecting fertility and manure loads on that farm. A newer test that came on in the last several years would be a DCAD package. It stands for dietary cation anion difference. And this is for our transition or close-up cows to determine what effects it may have on blood calcium. And this package, it is a wet chemistry analysis put together by labs, and we'll be testing for the two common anions, which would be chlorine and sulfur, and the two cations, which would be potassium and sodium. Armed with this information, we can now begin to calculate some values and use it in balancing rations. To calculate energy values and forages, the most common technique was to use predictive equations. This would be the Penn State equation for alfalfa. And so we'd estimate the net energy value of lactation based on this constant 1.044 and subtract from that the percent acid detergent fiber multiplied by this other value, 0.0123. So you would take and put in 40% acid detergent fiber on a dry matter base, multiply it by that constant, subtract it from that 1, and you would end up with a value probably in the 0.5 to 0.6 range. That was the old system. The new method, based on the new dairy NRC, is to calculate the actual nutrients in the forage. If we know how much fat, how much protein, how much fiber we have, and actually have a summative equation and calculate the energy or the nutrient value based on what it contains. A much more direct and sophisticated type of evaluation for energy. Of course, as we mentioned earlier, the two real powerful tests would be to do an in vitro test using rumen fluid in the lab in a flask, or to do an in situ test, which puts the feed inside the cow. Again, economics becomes a very important factor as well as repetitiveness of the analysis. Finally, we would also want to manipulate dry matter. So for all students, this is a basic concept of how to convert values back and forth. Once we have this information, now we can manipulate the dry matter contents on feed. Because remember, dry matter contains the nutrients, not the water. So here are several common manipulations all students should be able to accomplish. First, to convert from wet to a dry matter base using a forager feedstuff, you take the pounds of the wet forager feed and multiply that by the percent dry matter expressed as a decimal. So if a cow is eating 40 pounds of wet silage and it's 50% dry matter, that would be 0.5 times 40 or 20 pounds of dry matter. You may want to go the other direction, which means converting dry matter to wet feed, because that's how many computers or farmers think about feeding cows. So to go back from a dry to a wet feed, you take the pounds of dry matter and just do it backwards. Divide, in this case, by the percent dry matter expressed as a decimal. And so we'd get the same value. So you should be able to go either way, and we should get the same answer. When we balance rations, we always calculate rations based on a dry matter basis. So we always want students to convert feeds from a wet basis to a dry matter basis so that the water doesn't become a factor in terms of building the ration. Always work rations on a dry matter basis. That is the golden rule. Now, you can do it on a wet basis, but then you've got to make sure you convert all feeds to a wet basis, and that really makes it very difficult to interpret the results. Finally, let's summarize my recommendations here in Illinois. Now, if you're in Washington or New York or Canada, these recommendations wouldn't fit. But based on our growing conditions, feed costs, and land, we'd recommend the following. 2/3 of the forage dry matter coming from corn silage and 1/3 of the forage dry matter coming from hay silage or hay. Hay would be optional. This depends on particle size of the silage, and it could also be purchased. Why is it optional? Making hay in Illinois is difficult because of our high humidity and frequent rains in May and June. And our third forage recommendation, although it's not a real true forage, would be 5 pounds of fuzzy cottonseed. Fuzzy cottonseed behaves like a forage because it floats in the rumen and causes the cow to chew or cud, or add 3 pounds of a byproduct feed, which again is high in digestible fiber. Products such as soy hulls, corn gluten feed, beet pulp would be very common here in the Midwest, or citrus pulp in the southeastern parts of the United States. This concludes our module on forage aspects of dairy cattle. Thanks and have a good day.